Jamia, one of my first students is here. He was in first year degree Rosio. He is finishing his PhD in JNU now. He was my student in Jamia. And then I know quite a few people here, I realized. Other than these personal connections, student-teacher relationships I have here, it's our politics that I think connects us large, which is very welcome and heartening to see, because when I taught in Jamia, this was 2003-2004, I used to come to JNU often, and you will know JNU's political history much better than me. It was an ISR, SFI dominated, and even NSU I had quite a strong presence, and so did AVP. But after such kind of a politics, to see the space which Bapsa has carved for itself in JNU, it's really heartwarming for me and for many of us. So I congratulate you people on your organization, on your work, and I hope our strength will grow, in every sphere. I am not prepared for the talk, I wrote down few things so that I'll not give a scattered talk, but kind of stick to my script. But then I don't want to talk for long, maybe 15 to 20 minutes of talk, and it's not necessarily touching upon the imposition of Hindi. I mean, all of us, I am sure, are against it, and we know quite a lot. I don't know your name, but he spoke quite eloquently on constitutional and other kind of political discourse around language and language imposition. I'll largely touch upon how language knowledge is kind of constructed, and how institutionalized language actually has consequences for us. And imposing Hindi is nothing but institutionalizing language in a certain way, right? Institutionalizing a dominant language in a dominant manner. So I'll kind of touch upon the dominant language discourse. But then I also thought, the recent challenges from UGC, both in terms of seat cuts to giving interview boards in MPhil and PhD exams a full free hand. You don't want to consider the entrance exam marks, but you pick your PhD MPhil students only from the interviews. This is I really feel there is a direct link between the growing Ambedkarite thought in university campuses, and then the not only thought but Ambedkarite movement across universities. And university administration, UGC and government not only want to curtail funding to higher education, which is very obvious, but more importantly, what these governmental bodies want to do is to have a control over who is coming to the university and how they are coming to the university as well. So if you look at the recent policies of the UGCs, you can see the direct link. They want to have a say on how many people come into our MPhil programs, into our PhD programs, not only how many, but in what ways they come and who actually come. So, and it is here in this context, I think language also kind of plays a crucial role. So the growing number of marginalized students in the university, students who come from marginalized section, is obviously, as we all know, is not only to challenge the politics of the country, dominant politics of the country, but I think, and it is a challenge to what we understand as knowledge itself. Right? It's not only that our politics is countering their politics, but the way we understand knowledge, the way we construct an alternate discourse itself, is kind of challenge to what is perceived to be knowledge in this country or anywhere else in the world for that matter. So what of course, knowledge is perceived as something, we know it's perceived as very high, it is perceived as quite very sacred, knowledge is quite elite, erudite, and knowledge is not something that consists of our day-to-day lives. Knowledge is something where our day-to-day lives are something else. And it is through the entry of different sections of students that our day-to-day experiences and day-to-day lives have come to the fore of knowledge, have come to be understood as knowledge. And this is something that is not at all or what do you call, not at all agreeable to dominant understandings of knowledge. This dominant understanding of knowledge, which obviously is controlled by few, again, people who decide what kind of knowledge should be generously allowed, right? Until for a long time, whatever was considered knowledge was not allowed to a whole lot of us, from upper caste women to all, below the line of caste hierarchy. And in this so-called democratic liberal nation states, what is allowed as a universal ideal of literacy is also controlled through other manners, and one of this major way in which this knowledge is controlled is also through language, is what I argue. And it is here, I mean, there are two things. One thing he mentioned, how parliamentarians should speak in Hindi, or whoever knows to read and write Hindi should use Hindi in their parliamentary affairs. The other thing, I didn't hear if you mentioned or not, but making Hindi as a compulsory subject in all CBSE schools and NCERT schools that use the NCERT syllabus, right? This is more dangerous, in fact, than that of the parliamentary imposition. So changing already all the KV and CBSE schools do follow a compulsory Hindi program. In fact, if you are aware, most KVs, Jawaharlal Vidyalayas, do not teach the regional language. I mean, regional language story is another, we'll come to that in the end, because not to say that Tamil or Kannada or Marathi is less dominant than Hindi, they are dominant in their own regional kind of a setup. So we'll come to that later, but then all these KVs and CBSE based schools do not actually teach the regional language, but insist on Hindi. And after last year, you also have Sanskrit compulsory. And if the child wants, which is a fourth standard, fifth standard child, they can learn an extra language, which is their regional language. And that's an optional, like we have an optional course at the MA or higher levels. So if you want to learn your own language, you do it as an optional, you do it as an extra burden. It's not necessary for Hindi speakers to go through that a burden of learning another language. But if you are so passionate about learning our own mother tongues, our own languages, we can do that as an extra audit course. So that is what the CBSE rules right now says. And then last year there was also a German controversy. They removed German from the CBSE schools, but then the German Chancellor who was visiting India had a problem. She raised the issue with the government, and then now they have included German also as an extra optional course along with the regional language. So there is a whole lot of things. It's not just language and intimacy, my own tongue, my own emotion, passion, but whole lot of politics around this language issue, including that of the construction of knowledge and how trade relation between two countries basically works. So there's a whole lot of connections between these two things. So I'll start in the sense, I'll ask certain questions, and if in case you want to stop me in between and then clarify a certain point, please do that. You can stop me anytime you want when I'm reading this and talking. Is it only an issue of language when a certain language is imposed? I mean, is it only an issue of language in the sense, how does this language issue spill over other domains of our lives, is what I mean to ask? Or is it only the question of language isolated from other spheres of our lives? Do we see language only as a domain of cultural identity? Right? It is this language reflects my culture, this language expresses my culture. Somebody else's expression. So if you want to, it will like, one language can use to express a composite culture. So is language a medium to express only our cultural kind of a identity, or does it do something else? you know, do we see language as crucial to our lives and not just as the language we speak, not just as a means of communication? This is a very popular kind of a theory, right? The language is used as a means of communication, tool of communication. That is one school of thought. The other school of thought is language expresses our cultural identity. So within these two large spheres, understanding of language works. And for actually do we understand language as something that constructs knowledge itself, right? It is through knowledge that whatever we know, it is through language, whatever we know as knowledge is constructed. Language is the building block of knowledge construction. And what language we use, and not only whether it is Hindi, even within Hindi, what kind of Hindi is used to build that knowledge or discourse around that knowledge also becomes central. Not only does it shape politics of knowledge, obviously it also shapes identities much more. Going beyond cultural identities is what I have largely been say, but these identities, even language based identities, politics that are constructed via language are also not very equal. There's a whole lot of unequal identities that are created via language, through language. I'd like to just kind of trace a history on how social sciences, humanities have understood language for a long time. For a long time, our lives were understood as a binary between what is natural and what is known as right. Society is something as constructed, human-made, or to be very literal, man-made rules. Right? Society is something that is constructed out of human-made rules, whereas natural included language, but also included science, in the sense that science is something that explains everything that is around us, everything that is exists in nature, the physical matter that could be explained in a scientific way. So language and science actually were understood as belonging to the realm of nature and society as something that is constructed. No, but it is only later on, even as late as late 20th century, people started talking about how nature or even science is constructed pretty much like the construction of society. It's not that science is something so very rational. You can take the examples of Bruno Latour, if you know, or even Foucault to an extent, who explained that science and disciplines and the whole lot of things are actually constructed as against the society. Society, of course, is constructed, our roles, our communities, our identities are constructed, but as against the society, you have a gradual construction of science as well. So there is nothing natural about nature, there is nothing natural about science, but science is a construction pretty much equivalent to the construction of society. And therefore, the implication is also for language, right? Language is not something natural, not something intimate, not something you speak and learn, you know, as if there is no distance between you and language. But the question of language, the idea of language is also very constructed. In fact, there are people who have talked about how the idea of mother tongue itself is a very recent idea. Right? Mother tongue is not something which has been understood as something very close to us, something that what mother speaks come to you. In fact, if you look at border areas or kids belonging to different language speaking parents, you will see that the idea of mother tongue basically fails. Large number of people whom I know from Mizoram, Karnataka, which is bordering Telangana and Karnataka, or even Maharashtra, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Telangana, they would say, we speak Marathi and Kannada at home, we speak Marathi and Telugu at home. So there is no this familial kind of association with the language you speak at home. Right? Mother tongue itself becomes a very essentialized, very romanticized kind of an idea, which is a construction which is coming after the gradual growth of modern nation states in 18th and 19th century. And also, I mean, if you largely take split children from, there are studies around this, children from mixed with different languages, it is the father's tongue most likely to be, assimilated by the children and not the mother tongue. So there's a whole lot of dynamics involved here as well. Although children may also speak mother tongue, the linguistic kind of identity that the child takes would be that of the father more often than not. So, in fact, is this connection between the nation and a particular language, we all know that it is not at all a natural kind of a connection. And very often, most often than not, we kind of trace it to the growth of the idea of Western nation state, where one country is associated or connected to one certain language, right? English with England, or French with France, and Germany with German. But we often forget that Switzerland's official languages, they have four languages, if I'm not wrong. Belgium has also more than two. And there are many other European countries, Austria also I think has two, so which operate with more than one language. But our favorite examples will be to see European nations which have one language as their official kind of a language, which expresses, so-called expresses their national identity. But if you look at their own language histories, I mean, I'm sure you're aware how the Great Britain, how English itself kind of colonized Ireland first, and Gaelic, the language that is spoken in Ireland, was totally understood as barbaric, uncivilized in relation to English. And there is Welsh, and there is Cornish, and there is a whole lot of other kinds of non-English languages that are present in England. And gradually the way English, and especially the Queen's English, comes to be a marker of their national linguistic identity is a historical process in itself. So it's not that this link between the language, and this is true in France or any Italy or in Germany. And before this, the growth of the modern state, in fact, all this, as you know, were smaller provinces where there were different kinds of political systems, different kinds of languages used, and the gradual consolidation, standardization of a particular language has been a common thing across many countries in Europe, and never a kind of a natural kind of a connection that these people speak one language and therefore it expresses a kind of linguistic national identity. That has never been the question. It's been a gradual construction of a single dominant language, usually associated, as you know, with the clergy and the aristocracy. And that's how a certain kind of language comes to be associated with a certain kind of state. This one language has been, it has a history of being associated with one nation in contemporary times. What was the role of the language in the monarchic state form, which was largely the political state form prior to this nation state form? So what kind of language usage, what kind of, not policy perhaps, what kind of language dynamics worked in the monarchic state form? And does actually language signify dominance only in the modern state, or did language have a part? Did language have a part in what kind of role it had in the monarchic state form as well? In fact, I don't know, yeah, you must be familiar with James Scott, who very brilliantly argues as to how monarchic state forms, in fact, had a, even now for that matter, all these states form have a very small elite minority which were literate. Especially in the times of monarchic state forms, you have a very small elite who know to read and write. And that language, most often than not, was very different from that of the languages that were spoken by people. So for the purposes of administration, for the purposes of account keeping, for the purposes of religious activities, you have a very specialized kind of knowledge, specialized kind of language, which was considered high, which was considered obviously sacred. Here in the case of India, Sanskrit played a role in certain times. Also Persian, the language that was used in the courts, right, also was used for such purposes, in the court for literary purposes and for the purposes of state administrative kind of usage. In Italy, you know, or in Europe, Latin played such a role, a very highly literate, highly influential kind of small minority used these languages, where you common ordinary people totally were unaware, or they couldn't access such a language at all. So monarchic state form also had a language through which not only they controlled language knowledge, but also controlled a religion, also controlled the church, also controlled the state. So the account keeping, obviously the economy, was also in such a dominant language usage. So coming to the nation state form, it's a very ironic thing that if there was a very conscious kind of a control of knowledge during the monarchic state form, interestingly, in the nation state form, the supposedly democratic ideals make it kind of mandatory that literacy should be accessed by everyone, which means that each one of us should be able to do what the administrators or the state is able to do. So this is a very interesting thing, but how it has played out in the day-to-day lives is a totally different thing. Whether the language of the state, right, whether the language of the nation state has actually reached out to people, or people using their own languages have been able to access the democratic ideals of the so-called modern nation state. Although this has been an ideal, that is written in the democratic nation state, how far it has reached out and carried out is still a big question. It's also interesting that this kind of a language, which supposedly connects the nation, right, it expresses the nation's identity in a certain way, it's used both by a kind of right-wing politics, right-wing discourse, and it is also used by a certain kind of socialist liberals. For the right-wing, language or culture becomes a marker of connectivity that connects the nation, where all the differences are marked and the sameness is expressed through one single language. Right? But for the socialist liberal, a language is necessary so that, as I said, to access the rights of every citizen. Only when you know your rights, only when everyone is literate, will democratic ideals be established. So there is also a socialist ideal associated with this common knowledge. In fact, Madhav Prasad, in his article which is called The Political Commons, he makes a very interesting observation that language should be like a commons. I don't know if you know the idea of commons in older form of society, where commons is something that is accessible to everyone. There is a village common, a village meadow, where everybody could take their cows to graze. It is everybody's property. There were patches of meadows like that in largely agrarian kind of society. So language should play such a part of political commons, where everybody should be able to access the rights and ideals that are enshrined to them in constitution or elsewhere. So interestingly, this the right wing kind of a thought that wants a single language, and the socialist liberal kind of a thought which wants a single language for different purposes, but then via the same kind of a media, there is some kind of a paradox there between two different kind of thoughts. So in most of the places, I'm still reading out from the monarchic states type, pretty much everywhere it was the clergy and the aristocrats who worked together. And in the case of Hindu kind of a kingdoms, it was specifically the Brahmin, the Vanya and the royal who used the script, right? And the script becomes very crucial in understanding of the language in itself. So it's the Brahmin, Vanya and the aristocrat. So the written script to appease the god, to read the scripture, you can see the connection, the scripture, right, the holy book and the script. So there is a very strong connection between the written word and the religion per se as well. So the written word, the script is used for purposes of scripture to mediate between the god and the king, and you also needed the script, the written word, to keep the accounts, as I said, and also to inscribe the king's power, right, in many ways. It could be in temple, it could be in whatever kinds of stone inscriptions you find. So for accounting, for political and for religious purposes, you needed the scripted kind of a book. So knowledge in a way is defined in these terms, and we should keep this in mind, that it's not only knowledge gets defined, but knowledge gets defined only through the written word. It's not the oral, spoken or the day-to-day kind of a language that gets elevated, day-to-day kind of a language that gets elevated to the realm of knowledge, but the written form, very clearly defined in certain way, comes to be understood as knowledge or carrying knowledge. And as we know, not all languages that are spoken have had the necessity to have a script. My language, which is Kodava or Koorg language, we have never found the need to write our knowledge down. Many Adivasi languages, for example, knowledge of the oral systems work in a different manner altogether. Right? This history of oral languages work in a different ways, work in different kinds of stories. The knowledge is passed down through a different method altogether and not through written history. But that, as you know, is not history enough, is not knowledge enough. It is only the written, the script. We often forget that all the written languages, in fact, are also spoken languages. The other way is not true. All spoken languages need not have a script, but all written languages are also spoken, except perhaps Sanskrit, which is not spoken but written down, right? So there is very a contradiction of this kind, because you kind of associate the script with the language, which is a very incorrect manner of understanding languages as carriers of knowledge or carriers of knowledge systems itself, because there is nowhere actually in the world where a language is considered language when it has a script. All the most European knowledge of the languages, I keep shifting between language and knowledge. So most European languages, take Spanish, take French, take English, they all use the Roman script. They are different languages on their own right? Many North Indian languages use the Devanagari script in some form or the other. They are languages in their own right. But when you talk of Kodava, you talk of Gond, right? People ask me, what's your mother tongue? Kodava. Do you have a script? First, of course, most people wouldn't know. That's fine. Now, India has some 1,000 or so languages. We are not expected to know everything. Especially Hindi speakers are not expected to know anything else, right? So, okay, then they'll say, okay, Kodava, does it have a script? I say, no. But is it a language? The connection between people make, not only, it also includes people in the university, it also includes people who do language studies and comparative literature. So, there is such a close connection between language and the script. They often forget that French and English and Spanish have the same script. Punjabi uses Gurmukhi, but is it a variant of Devanagari? I'm not very sure. But even Bangla, Marathi, whatever Hindi you want to call, and then Gujarati, they all use the variant of Devanagari script, but they are all languages. Right? When it comes to minority Adivasi languages, script becomes a marker for a language. Otherwise, it's better you identify with the dominant language of the region. Oh, so you also know Kannada. We are taught Kannada in schools, right? So Kannada is the language of school, Kannada is the language of knowledge, right? If you know Kodava, I mean, obviously there is no market, but then there is nothing else also. It's basically useless because it doesn't have a script. But I always insist that there is no connection between script and language. Now the digital media, in fact, is helping my argument because you can type any language using Roman script and you're pretty much understood, right? So if you kind of signify certain words which signify certain kind of vowels, your script is pretty much ready. You don't have to have a script to write a particular language. You can write Hindi in Roman. You can, most of the Northeastern languages use the Roman script. Right? So that they find it more liberating than using the Devanagari script or using Bengali script, which many languages did in the Northeastern part of the country. So this connection between script and language is something which has to be broken. In fact, I was telling you about James Scott. He very brilliantly argues how many tribes across Southeast Asia, from Burma to the long stretch of Indonesia, there are people who have consciously kept away from the written form. In fact, keeping away from the written form for Scott means you are keeping away from the nation state itself. Right? So you are beyond the nation state. You don't subscribe to the history of the nation state. So you want your stories in the spoken form, you want your stories in your form, which is fluid. Written history may be valued by certain cultures, but oral histories give you a kind of fluidity, impermanence, and changing according to the context, which is much more valued by these tribes across the region. And this is something more knowledgeable, something more, even though it is impermanent, it is a kind of permanence that is valued, unlike the kind of history that is written down. Associated with script is that most oral languages, most smaller languages, they're taught to be as if they're useless, they don't have a script. But when they don't have a script, the next question is, oh, you don't have literature. As if literature is something that every human being aspires for, and as if literature gives food to every human being, right? So that becomes such a connected thing associated with the script. You don't have a literature, or you don't have a history, by which they mean you don't have a written history. And these three categories, right? Language, literature, and history, if you remember, has been central to the construction of the nation state across the world in the modern kind of a period, right? You consciously construct a literary history that goes down to the ages and therefore connect whole of India or whole of England. You trace a kind of a past through which you connect the people, and this is very centrally done using literature and literary history of a certain kind. So when oral kind of languages do not have these three categories, but of course they have other categories which are not considered, these languages are considered belonging to the very private kind of a realm. So you have the dominant kind of a language, which could be Kannada as well or Hindi, which are in the public domain. Firstly used by the monarchic nation state, and now officially used by the nation state as well. So for administrative purposes, and now in contemporary times for education and for business, you have the institutionalized dominant languages which are in the public realm, right? But then the oral spoken languages come to be spoken in the private kind of a realm. There is also a very interesting kind of, many people have read this as a public masculine kind of a language that is used, whereas these oral languages, since they are very private, right, you speak your own languages, small languages at home. You don't speak it in the public. In the public, you speak the dominant language. So in private, since it's largely within the domestic sphere, it becomes a very feminized kind of a language without having a script as well. So script and institution stands for a certain kind of masculine understanding, whereas the languages used in the domestic sphere comes to be seen as very feminine, very useless. Basically, feminine knowledge is not really, you know, useful, and so on and so forth. Very little more I have to say. So it is, you know, it is quite sad that Hindi itself is, the history of Hindi is, most of you would be aware of the history of Hindi itself. What is actually Hindi, right? What gave way to the rise of Hindi during the nationalist movement, late 19th century and early 20th century, through the work of people in literature, people in the nationalist movement, how they constructed a standardized kind of a Hindi. This is another story, because from what little I know of Hindi, there are Awadhi speakers, there are Magadhi speakers, there are Bhojpuri speakers, there are a whole lot of speakers, there are Bundeli speakers, right? But how does all these kind of language, linguistic identities come to be under the domain of, you know, Hindi? Like he was just saying, right? So this 45% of Hindi speakers is just a constructed myth. All these linguistic identities are consumed, assimilated under this larger umbrella of Hindi. And of course, this construction, standardization of Hindi itself, as you know, was pitted against, juxtaposed against Urdu or Hindustani, which is, you know, religious kind of a binary between the Hindu and the Muslim as well. So construction of Hindi, legitimizing it, standardizing it, Sanskritizing it from the Khadi Boli kind of a usage, which was so very different, so very varied across northern parts of India, is itself a story in itself, is itself a story. But then using this Hindi to impose, as if Hindi could bring the national kind of a unity. After 70 years of independence, if you still, you know, talk about this ideal of unity, then I am not sure where we are, you know, going. So, this, sadly again, this is also the story in Pakistan. Urdu is nobody's mother tongue there. Right, it is Punjabi, it is Baluchi, it is Sindhi, it is, there are so many other languages, and Urdu is not one. But consolidation of modern state, nation states along with the religious kind of a hegemony, you see how it operates, pretty much similar both in India and in Pakistan, if you look at the language scenario. Here it is Sanskritized kind of a Hindi, there it is kind of a very courtly kind of a Urdu, which everyone has to learn in school, right? It is a unity that is very consciously woven through the different linguistic and cultural identities of Pakistan as well. So, and of course, I mean, all of us know that education, what I was telling you in the beginning, education is one of the major institutions through which so-called national identity, so-called national unity has been, as we all know, constructed, and therefore history has been one of the most contentious, you know, school textbooks. But then language is also another kind of contentious kind of usage within the school system. Although constitution makes provisions for the propagation of Hindi, it has given us time to use Hindi at all official levels. Constitution again has given us the right, if I'm not wrong, Article 29 and 13, right for minorities to preserve and propagate their own minor languages. right to minorities to use their mother tongue, to demand for their mother tongue education in the school they are studying. This provision is also there, right? But then how it happens, and people talk about all kind of logical kind of problems. There are no textbooks in Kodava, there are no textbooks in Gondi, there are no textbooks in this Bill language, right? But you go back, you just have to go 100 years back. Were there textbooks in Kannada? Were there textbooks in which comes to be known as the pure Kannada? Whereas even today, you know, people laugh at the kind of Kannada the North Karnataka people speak, right? So there is a whole lot of politics involved in what kind of language gets into the making of the textbooks itself. And then, not only what language comes into the textbook, but how it comes. How it comes, what goes into the lesson, and how language, you know, plays via all these things. There are a whole lot of questions I hope you will take up for your own research and so on. So it's the imposition of Hindi at one level. I'm sure people will, state governments will counter it in one way or the other. I hear the Kerala government says all CBSE schools, whichever it is, you know, should teach Malayalam in their schools. Teaching Malayalam, am I right? Many of you know. So whether it is Hindi imposition or not, states also have a say in education. Education is also a state department, right? So state departments do counter it in their own way. But, you know, on the other hand, what Malayalam has done to the Adivasi languages or other kind of, you know, whether it is Arabi Malayalam or whether it is, you know, of different kinds of regional variations within Malayalam, largely the Adivasi languages, what it does to them, you know, by imposing Malayalam on its own students, its own population. So this is not one kind of language, doesn't play as, you know, from a central kind of a authority to down below. But, you know, there is this interesting term used by Bodhisattva Karma. He says, this language through which you expect people to be educated, people to be civilized, people to come out of their barbaric kind of situations, largely oral, tribal and other languages, there is an infinite possibility, there is an infinite possibility to reproduce the improvement template. In the sense, the missionary work, what is an improvement template? The missionaries worked, the native intelligentsia worked to improve Kannada, to arrive at a pure Kannada. Similarly, to arrive at a pure Hindi, right? There's a whole lot of work going on to arrive at a pure Hindi. But then when Hindi comes to the status of pure, civilized, institutionalized, then you look upon other languages as something to be improved, something to be lifted out of their you know, ignorant status. So this improvement template is kind of reproduced infinitely. So whether it is Kannada also, Kannada always claims that Tulu, Konkani, Kodava are sister languages, younger sisters, right? Not elder sisters. You have to improve them. You have to make them come to you, right? So this is the, you know, so that you will bring them up largely, like with the familial kind of an association. You don't want, it's a threat if they become individuals of their own right. So you have to always kind of assimilate them in order to kind of build whether a Kannada identity or a kind of a, you know, a Hindu, Hindi, India kind of identity, so that this threat is kind of consciously addressed in a very assimilative kind of a manner through imposition. That assimilation largely is happening through this kind of a language imposition and associatedly with the construction of knowledge which comes with all the kind of language discourses that we know. I'll stop here. I thank all of you. Please